Thank you. Welcome. Thank you for joining us here today for the first talk of the spring semester in the Communication Research Colloquium Series. Today we have to speak with us Assistant Professor Brad Tober. He recently joined us here this past year at BU, here in the College of Communication. He has a formal background in multiple degrees in both design and mathematics.
That's long.
Thank you, Kayla. Brad's research, often exploratory or speculative in nature, investigates emerging and novel digital communication technologies, particularly those that are interactive, as well as the potential relationships these technologies may have, both with pedagogy as well as a professional practitioner pursuit. Lots of P's there. Today he'll be discussing with us the topic of the democratization of design and the implications both for professional endeavor as well as pedagogy, and introducing us to this concept of meta-design as well as potential implications. So again, if you would, please give a warm welcome to Professor Tober.
Thank you, everyone. Good afternoon. I apologize in advance. I have getting over a cold, so I'm still a bit congested and may come through in the talk today. But no, it's really great to have this opportunity to talk to you and to get the chance to communicate to COM about what it is I'm doing. I'm in somewhat a novel position here at COM too, and finding my place over this first year here. So, like Jim said, a lot of my work, again, is speculative, is experimental, in an exploratory sense, and in the past few years, that has kind of narrowed down to this idea of meta-design and meta-design explorations. And so that's what I'm going to talk about today. Also, the idea of, what is design, what is design research, and how does that actually connect and relate to communication in a broader sense. So, one of the biggest challenges being a designer is in actually defining what design is. I would hazard to guess that if you would ask 100 designers what design is, you would get 100 different responses. And that's problematic because it creates a somewhat disjoint discipline. Design as a profession even is not even 100 years old. The term was first coined, graphic design specifically, in the early 1900s. And when we look at design's position in academia and the design of, and the idea of design as a potential approach to research, that's even newer. So when it comes down to defining design, that's a challenge. And in part, it's really due to the fact that many of the things we see, or many of the things we think of as design, are visible. We think about things like typefaces and books and posters and signs and websites. These are the most visible forms of design. So they would come to mind when you think about what design is and what it might be. And Siri is now responding to me as I'm trying to use the remote. Okay. But there's actually so much more to it. And design encompasses things like ideas in a very broad sense. Interactions, information, systems, services. But those are these kind of invisible manifestations of what design is. And so when we try to take a broader view of what design is and can be, it becomes difficult to come up with a definition that actually encompasses all of these things. So out of the many definitions of design there are, one of my favored ones is this from Herbert Simon. And this is sort of a paraphrase, but design is the development of courses of action aimed at changing existing situations into preferred ones. So Herbert Simon was actually a Nobel Prize winner in economics in 1978. And one of the really valuable aspects of this definition, I think, is the fact that it does not define design as, for example, visual communication. In a lot of settings, you will see that. You'll see, for example, academic programs that offer a program in design sometimes will call their program visual communication. Now, there's not necessarily a problem with that, but I think when we look at a definition like this, there's the potential to position design alongside communication in a way, because here we see that, well, you know, perhaps communication could actually be defined in a very similar way in terms of the transfer and sharing of knowledge. So this is something that I think is valuable to look at and think about as we move forward. So when we keep that in mind, it really makes sense that both the past and the present of both design and communication are inextricably linked. They have much in common. We look at, you know, historical examples. You know, we look at the beginning of communication, cave paintings in Lascaux. We look at the printing press, or more specifically, the idea of movable type being used in the printing press. We look at the Macintosh in 1984. And the implications that had for digital publishing, for example. And then more recently, we look at something like the smartphone. And, you know, when we look at these in the sense of the technological advances that each represented, the importance is not so much in the fact that, you know, each of these is actually some sort of designed artifact in its own right. But it's actually what each of these meant for facilitating the behaviors of others, okay? And then the potential that they represent. So this idea of technology, and arguably the smartphone is the strongest example of this in the sense that, you know, technology and specifically technology that enables creativity has become increasingly accessible. And there's a number of reasons for that. First, for, you know, the increased pace of technological development, the increased reach of technology and its accessibility in terms of cost and scale and all of those sorts of characteristics. And that really has informed and created this environment where technology is undergoing this process of democratization. So the idea of, you know, these tools being made accessible to a broad audience that previously did not have access to it. And this is enabling them to, you know, create, to see their ideas executed, to transform their ideas into some other form. And so there's a quote that I think actually really captures what this means for design and how we have to position design and the professional design practitioner. This comes from Andrew Blaubelt. He's a designer, design writer, curator. He's currently director at the Cranbrook Art Museum. Cranbrook is a school just outside Detroit. And he says that, today's world of open source computing, social networking, crowdsourcing, user-generated content, app store platforms, and other manifestations of the participatory culture of Web 2.0 suggest systems that are more radically open in nature, soliciting input from and empowering creation by many users. Although the rhetoric of decentralized authority pervades these endeavors, the question of control as an expression of authority and design's role in it lingers. It's not simply a question of no control or no design, but rather it's a question of where control and design happen in an open system. So there's a question, and to answer questions, we have to perform research, okay? So design research is very much in its infancy. You know, I would say that, like previously I said, you know, ask 100 designers what design is, you'll get 100 answers. Ask 100 design researchers what design research is, you'll get 200 answers. That's what it is. But this is an overview of, you know, how I conceptualize design research as it is currently. One side of it involves investigations that either use design or prompt and pursue investigations through design. You might have heard the term design thinking. Has anyone heard that term? No. So design thinking is very much, it's the application of design methods and design processes to areas outside of design. Okay. Many sort of, I would say, client-based investigations actually involve design thinking and this side of design research. One of the biggest design thinking consultancies actually has an office here in the area, IDEO. They have offices in Cambridge. They're huge. If you're not familiar with their work, look into them. So design thinking is a big thing. But it is also very much heavily tilted towards industry and how research can actually service those sorts of pursuits. The other side of design research involves investigations of design itself. And so this is really what a lot of academic design research is currently. Okay. And this itself takes two forms. There's practice-based design research, and there's practice-led design research. And the distinction here is somewhat subtle, but practice-based design research involves the creation of creative artifacts. So someone engages in a design process, and there is a somewhat tangible outcome of that process as a result. And that result, that outcome of the process, that designed artifact, the thing that has been designed, is in fact the contribution to design knowledge. Okay. In practice, led design research, which is really what I kind of conceptualize a lot of my work to be, but I'm kind of all over the place as well. Practice-led design research is a type of or conceptualization of research where advances are made in regards to knowledge about how practice occurs and how it takes place. This includes practice as an integral part of its method. So practice-led design researchers are still engaging in processes of design, but there's kind of this bigger picture view in the fact that these types of researchers are interested in the implications of their work beyond the work itself. So this kind of prompts this idea of meta-design, and meta-design really is what it sounds like. When we append this prefix of meta to design, we're actually looking at what it means to design design and to think about what it means to kind of push the discipline and define what design currently, beyond what it currently is, what it can be and what the potential is. So, and this is my definition that I would propose, in that meta-design actually shifts the designer's role from that of executing processes in which the objective is producing finalized creative output to engaging directly with the development of tools that actually facilitate the creative processes of others. Okay. So in this case, the meta-designer isn't creating design artifacts. They're creating tools, they're creating frameworks that others then use to create design artifacts. And this is important because this ties directly to the idea of, and the implications of, democratization of design technologies. When non-designers get access to technologies and tools that designers previously had, professional designers previously had exclusive access to, well, there becomes the question of, well, what is design? Who is a designer if, you know, by using a very specific type of tool, you can create some sort of outcome of a process that, well, looks like design or is design. You know, probably one of the biggest examples, and I'm sure we're all guilty of it, is with smartphones, the number of camera apps and photo apps that are available on here. You know, who is a professional photographer? If, you know, you look in, actually in the T, and I think at, I see these at Park Street right now, there's ads about shot on iPhone 7, right? So Apple currently has the ad campaign, shot on iPhone 7. These are great photos, these are great images. They're not taken by photographers. And the fact that these images are being enabled by, you know, the extreme prevalence of tools, including the hardware and software, is amazing. So really we have to think about, well, then what is it that the designer, the professional designer actually does? What is it that the professional photographer does that's different than someone with their phone and a phone app, a camera app? So the term meta design is not entirely new, but it seems like there has been a bit of a lull in any references to it. As far as I can tell, it was first coined in 1986 by Donald Knuth. Donald Knuth is actually, well, he's the developer of something called Metafont. Okay, so Metafont is a descriptive language for designing typefaces, designing fonts. Kind of like a markup language, if we're looking at it from that side of things. Metafont, it's this kind of parameterized system for defining the shape of characters, of glyphs, as parts of a typeface. And so in the Metafont book that he published and wrote in 1986, he notes that meta design is much more difficult than design. It's easier to draw something than it is to explain how to draw it. Okay, so think about that for a second. Why might that be? well, one of the reasons is that, first of all, in many cases involving meta design, designers need to actually have an entirely different skill set for creating meta designs and for creating the frameworks in which others can actually create design artifacts. One of those skills is writing computer code, okay, so programming. And there's a lot of work being done in that area that actually formulates a lot of my research interests involving pedagogy, but so we think about some of the skill sets, the new skill sets that are necessary for that sort of work. And then there, again, I mentioned this idea of frameworks. That is, you aren't thinking about creating with a single target in mind. When you're designing and you're developing a framework, you need to keep open to an entire realm or spectrum of possibilities. And you need to consider a vast more number of variables that can exist within that framework. And so you have to make these considerations for what all of the most reasonable possibilities within that framework might be. So I'm going to take the time now to talk about two projects, two significant projects that I've worked on. And then I have four questions that actually relate to ongoing work that I'm doing. And so the first project is called Colorigens. This project is in some ways a response to this question of what implications for and approaches to interaction design might emerge through developing software and its user interface for a novel, tangible hardware platform. Okay. So what is that hardware platform? So the Siftio cubes. Siftio cubes, I have one of the cubes here. If you're interested in seeing this project at some other date, I mean, it's in my office, and I'm happy to give you a demo. But Siftio cubes, this was a tangible hardware platform developed by a startup out of San Francisco, Siftio. few years ago. They were in late 2014, bought out by 3D Robotics, and their hardware was discontinued, and so whatnot. That's always disappointing. That's also, I will tell you, that is a risk one takes when you are working with emerging technologies. The risk is that that technology may disappear, and there is no substitute for it. But the idea, this hardware platform consists of these small cube devices. Each one has an LCD screen. That screen is touch sensitive. It has accelerometers, so sense motion. It also has proximity sensors, so that the cubes, you have multiple cubes, when you touch them together on different sides, they are aware of that interaction. And the hardware was introduced with a very minimal degree of availability of software applications available for it. They kind of developed this app store, but they only ended up getting a few titles that were available there. And they also, in terms of interface, weren't necessarily taking advantage and making and leveraging the hardware affordances of the platform. So this was something that, you know, I was actually interested in investigating as a designer, looking at, you know, what is the interface potential of a platform like this. And also at the time, so prior to BU, I taught at the University of Illinois for 5 years in the graphic design program. I also taught in the design foundations, so that would be like the first year of any art and design student. And so at the time I was actually teaching a class where I was covering topics in color theory. Okay, so really at that time I was interested in color theory and color mixing, and colorigens became a tactile color mixing and matching game. The idea was that, and we can actually watch through this demo, that there are these cubes at the top that kind of represent solid colors you might get at paint. You get a target color that the objective is to match by mixing the different source colors. And you mix colors by neighboring certain cubes to other cubes. You also start out with kind of these empty cubes with the transparency grid on them. And then when you mix two colors together, you kind of get this progress indicator. The goal is to reach a certain score. 97% was actually came down to a calculation of errors in the calculation of the mixing values. But something that was also interesting with this was that this was actually a system simulating subtractive mixture of color. So typically when we're working with digital displays or with light of any sort, we're actually working in an additive color system with primaries of red, green, and blue. And that color mixture system is actually not very intuitive at all. And it really comes down to, you know, our education in color mixture. But the idea is that, you know, a color, like when you mix red and green light, you actually get yellow. Right, and that's something that doesn't necessarily make sense when you're thinking about color mixture. So this system actually, the computation behind it, this is sort of where my mathematics background comes into play, is actually quite complicated. Anyway, this project has been, fortunately, has been relatively well received in the sense that I've been able to exhibit it at venues all over the world. And it's also had a wide range of appeal. You know, I've had the opportunity to to work with children in the sense that, okay, you know, use this as a potential teaching tool, right, for how color mixture operates. Or working with, in the second picture from the left here, a fine artist, a painter, who was actually very apprehensive. So in a lot of the settings where I exhibit this, it's a somewhat intimate interaction with them, with the user. And the idea that, so this particular individual, she came up to me and was a bit apprehensive about this technology. And with, you know, with good reason, it was a new technology. It represents an interface paradigm that there's very little precedent for in terms of how interfaces and how tangible hardware actually operates. But once she kind of gave in to her play instinct, the idea of, okay, let's explore this. Let's see what feels right in terms of how this should operate. She actually found it quite rewarding to work with. And then this past summer, actually, I was in Sao Paulo and was exhibiting at, it's the largest digital art event in Latin America. So, FILI is what it's called. So, and then last photo was in Glasgow. So this has been great. And the response in terms of, you know, being able to document anecdotally the takeaways that users take from interacting and engaging with the system. You know, it's kind of an informal system of user testing, you know, looking at building upon what users already know about interfaces, building upon what users are apt to take away just by how an interface looks, you know, how it should operate. You know, the hardware goes a long way in terms of being engaging and being like, oh, you know what, this is something you want to hold. This is something that you want to touch. You want to reach out and do something with, even if you don't know what that thing is. And then again, you know, this isn't necessarily a completely new revelation, but the idea of, you know, not punishing users for making incorrect decisions as they explore and navigate an interface. On the contrary, you actually want to reward them for kind of taking the initiative to try and learn things. So this project, in terms of this, you know, kind of exploratory activity that I'm interested in, is really about setting an example and building somewhat of a model for other designers who, you know, may develop an interface for a similar system in the future. Second project. It's called Design by Tweet. And so the question that this is a response to is, you know, how might appropriating a social media platform increase the accessibility of creative code? And so what is creative code? Well, like I had mentioned earlier, code, computer programming, is a completely necessary skill set for meta designers to have. And, you know, not just meta designers, but really contemporary design professionals of all sorts. And the best example of an environment for creative coding that I can give is processing. Who has heard of processing? Okay, so processing is a creative code environment. It facilitates the programmatic creation of images, of interactions, of animations. It was developed in the early 2000s at the MIT Media Lab by Ben Fry and Casey Reese. And their project was actually in response to an earlier project, Design by Numbers, which was developed by John Maeda, who was teaching at MIT at the time. And so Design by Numbers was somewhat of a more primitive version of what processing started off as and what it's become today. So processing is huge. It has a very large community behind it. It's open source. It's free to download. But this project this project was a response to the fact that, you know, for as easy or as much as a project like processing has facilitated individuals being able to engage with a process of creative programming, for example, there are still barriers to entry to that. The fact is, well, you have to know it exists, first of all. You have to know that such a thing as processing exists. You have to go to the website, you have to download a specialized software tool, you have to learn how the interface of this software tool operates, even as relatively straightforward it is. And so the idea is, well, what if we kind of co-opt something that there's a much larger audience for already, and something like, for example, Twitter. So Semi-Tweet is a project that kind of exists in the cloud. It's a cloud project. It's above our heads somewhere. And it lets you code visuals with tweets by using a processing-inspired API. So API stands for Application Programming Interface. It's basically the set of rules that come along with a programming language. So what are all the commands, what are all the variables that kind of make a programming language work? And so the processing project has an API, and Design by Tweet uses a very limited subset of that API to kind of enable people to write tweets in a very specific format and then get some sort of image tweeted back to them. Okay. And John was intrigued enough to retweet my tweet about this, since I tagged him in it. But if you're interested in this, we're going to look at a brief demo of it, but you can access this and you can use it as well. You can go to my website, bradtober.com, or you can actually access via this site as well, experimentalinterfacelab.org/dbt. It's also interesting because I get notifications via Twitter when someone actually engages with this, and it's been a little bit of a while, but someone today, just earlier today, was doing something on it, which was timely, I guess. So there's a Twitter profile for Design by Tweet. I should note it's a collaborative process, so everyone is working simultaneously on the same canvas, the same image. So, for example, if Agent Coco got the image to this point, and I were to then send a tweet that were to, you know, add some sort of visual element to the canvas, it would appear on top of what Agent Coco already did. This is not up to date either, but just a screenshot of that page. So again, yes, this is what I'm going to put it here. Nope, what's that? So the current image, the most recent tweet that the Design by Tweet Twitter profile has is the current state of the composition. So you write out a tweet to Design by Tweet with some commands. And you know, the description of all those commands is on my website. But send that tweet out. Design by Tweet responds with the image that incorporates the results of the commands that you tweeted. Okay. So again, yeah, there's a documentation page on my website, it's like that. So I think that's actually very clearly the, and it's probably one of the strongest examples of the project that I've done that is actually tied to my current definition of meta design. This idea, well, you know, Design by Tweet is not a design artifact. It's actually, you can't touch it at all. You can't even see Design by Tweet. What you see is the results of people engaging with it as a tool and using it to explore their own creative side. So those are the two projects. So now I have four questions. Ongoing work, ongoing projects that I'm working on. And the first is actually related to design by tweet. So, and this question is, you know, how might learning to code creatively develop transferable skills relevant to other areas of designers or creative communicators' practice? And this, this is important because when we think about, when you hear people talk about language, the benefits of learning a language, you know, a spoken language, the idea is that, well, there's the argument that there are cognitive benefits to learning a language that perhaps can carry over to other areas that you might be engaged with. And so there's also then the argument that if you learn to code creatively, if you learn to use something like processing or design by tweet perhaps, that the idea is that, well, perhaps there is the potential for increased visual acuity in some sense. So the idea of, you know, for example, you know, when you're writing one of these design by tweet tweets and you want to place a rectangle in a certain location, well, you have to understand the coordinate system for this canvas. You have to place, you have to use numbers to actually place that rectangle in a certain location. And the idea is, well, you know, you do that enough times, does that enable you to perhaps better estimate visually the location of things over time? So this is actually a project with potential for some significant empirical studies to be done. And so that is something that's in progress, at least in the back of my head. Something a little bit further along, how might data visualization be used as a tool to give backers of projects on Kickstarter and Indiegogo predictive agency through a clear understanding of the variables associated with success or failure of a campaign? So this is a collaboration with a colleague of mine at Oregon State University. We've been talking about topics such as data visualization. That's another area of specialty I have. But also she has interests in entrepreneurship and graphic design in general, information design. And so one thing that we've noticed in all sorts of campaigns on crowdsourced platforms like Kickstarter and Indiegogo is that when you get to the section that talks about risks and challenges, it's pretty weak in terms of the way that the developers of campaigns actually present the potential issues that they may encounter along the way. And, you know, the degree of variability that that section has across campaigns also makes it really difficult for backers to understand how those potential risks and challenges may play out and whether they'll, you know, get their money. Money's worth of whatever product they're backing, or you know, if the campaign fails, whether they'll get anything back or whatever. I mean, I think one of the biggest things recently, the Pebble smartwatch. So Pebble smartwatch, they're a company, and they were a relatively established company, but they've run a number of successful Kickstarter campaigns, and they were recently. They weren't bought out. There was a term they used because their intellectual property was acquired, but the company was not something, and whatever. Their most recent campaign, which was huge, was made, I guess one of the largest ever on Kickstarter. The product that they were raising money for in the end is falling through, and so. How do you predict that? How does a backer know and actually understand the risk involved with backing a campaign? And so we're looking at visual ways to do that. And in particular, how data visualization might be used to visualize certain metrics associated with success or failure, and specifically in a user-centered way towards the backers. There are kind of analytics tools for those that run the campaigns. But all of that is actually not very focused on the backer. And I mean, the backer is ultimately who makes a campaign successful or not. So we're interested in this. So this question, what are the cognitive implications of an interface that changes information based less on conscious intent than on immediate interest? And how might immediacy fundamentally change our relationship to media and decrease the divide between human and computer? This is a collaboration with colleagues of mine at NC State, and it involves eye tracking. So the idea is that, you know, when you are engaging with a computer, an interface using a keyboard or a mouse, you have to think about how you are going to respond to a stimulus from the computer before you can actually respond. But your eyes don't lie in the way that when you are looking at something on a screen, for example, that is a response in and of itself. And it may have a different meaning than one that you might respond to with, you know, a mouse or keyboard, but there is the potential for, you know, that sort of response and how it plays into the design of interfaces to change this relationship. So this is something that we're working on. A colleague is actually was with me at Illinois, but we both went on to new opportunities this past year. But this is an exciting project. And then the last question right now, is how might interactive dynamic data visualization form the basis of a model for building and strengthening communities? And I'm really excited about this question in the sense that I think there are actually some opportunities for perhaps collaboration here at COM on this. And it really stems from a lot of what has happened over the past months to years in terms of our political climate and the idea that perhaps many of the issues we're encountering is down to simply not understanding those around us as best we can. And so I'm interested in looking at, well, you know, how might interactive dynamic data visualization actually help to facilitate a process of understanding those around us? A non-digital example would be these post-it note installations that really, you know, we have one at COM, but we've also seen these pop up all across the country. And the idea that, you know, this is a way to get those around us engaged, to spark a conversation, to actually just facilitate a process of engagement across a community. Now, in terms of what this might look like, I'm actually really interested in this platform that Google has developed. It's called AnyPixel. Middle of last year, Google released this open source. It's kind of a software development kit for building these large installations of kind of dynamic displays. And so in Google's New York office, they assembled this array of, it's 5,000 something arcade buttons, and they each have an RGB LED inside of them, and so it's display, but each pixel is also its own button, and so I really don't want to imagine how expensive this was. There's no information regarding that, but the idea of having this sort of interface to facilitate a process of communicative data visualization surrounding communities is something of great interest to me. And I've actually already talked to Chair Chris and Tom as well, and they're also on board with a project that would perhaps allow some sort of engagement here at COM. I'm working on kind of a position paper that might describe some of what the potential is here. And when I'm done with that, I hope to share it and then perhaps get some input and involvement in that way. So the past and present of design communication are inextricably linked, but I think it's pretty clear that also the future is, and that you know, this is probably very appropriate, again, in the time that we are currently. It's really not acceptable to be satisfied by the status quo and to operate only within the standards that already exist for our areas of work. And so, if anything, I think this is hopefully a prompt or a call to be interested in taking action, chart our own courses forward, and to think about the ways that, you know, we might actually, as both professionals and researchers, we might ensure our continued agency in our respective practices. So, and in that sense, meta-design is but one possible path forward. That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Tober. Do we have any questions from the audience?
Yes.
Are you familiar with the idea of choice architecture? And if so, where would you situate that with this broad definition of design that doesn't really specify visual elements?
I am not familiar with this term specifically.
Kind of the idea that you, say, laying out the options in a survey question, or on a cafeteria line, the order you present things is really influencing the choices people make, and there's an element of either unintentional design if you just do it at random, or that you will be very intentionally designing things to prompt certain choices from people who see the, we're seeing the cafeteria as an interface, but the interface you create is kind of rhetorical tool almost.
So you're suggesting that, in the sense that, you know, I'm presenting this definition of design, and I can go back to all the way. Okay, we look at. So this definition?
Yes.
Okay. So are you suggesting then that in terms of the designer's role, according to this definition of presenting courses of action, that dependent on what those courses of action might be and the different variables involved with them, that they may receive certain priority over others, or?
More kind of just questioning how you consider something like the Amazon checkout process, where you're kind of, does the design elements try to push you to actually complete the purchase as soon as you start making it, to simplify it in certain ways, very intentionally using visual design, using code to kind of push the process along towards the desired outcome. Would you consider that a type of design?
Okay. Yeah, certainly. But I think it's important to then consider the perspectives kind of encompassed in that process. So for example, in, you know, really any sort of shopping cart, right, the idea that, you know, if we're looking at this definition, changing existing situations into preferred ones, from Amazon's perspective, right, their preferred situation is that you buy more products from them, right? And, you know, they are then looking at your existing situation of whatever's in your shopping cart and making suggestions as to, well, you know, perhaps based on, you know, this certain product, you might also be interested in this product. Or, you know, people that buy these products together also buy this product. Or, so those sorts of considerations. But that's an approach to design that, you know, perhaps in some situations could be viewed as user-centered. But, you know, I think that that's also, that's a very business-oriented design decision that, you know, maybe is not or does not have the considerations or full considerations of the user in mind. And that's something that, you know, I think is important for designers to keep in mind, and that this is also a distinction that designers have to make with artists, so for example, and that, and I'm going to preface this by saying that this is not intended to be a kind of all-encompassing generalization, but artists create for themselves, whereas designers create for others. And that's very broad, and I don't mean to offend anyone that might take offense to that, but that's a common distinction. And so that's, I think that's something to keep in mind, and that the user in really any sort of design process going forward needs to be kind of central to that activity. I don't know if that, okay. Yes.
With the Design by Tweet project,
yes.
Because it's a shared canvas, have you ever had any sort of conflict between users over sharing the canvas, or is it generally fairly amicable?
There have not been any conflicts. It's really been so. It's been exploratory, you know. People have stumbled across this, seen it, they've engaged with it in a way that, you know, they're trying it out. They're experiencing the novelty of it. I will say that, you know, the result of that is that none of these things are necessarily aesthetically pleasing. It's really just a jumble of a bunch of things that people have tested until someone kind of gets the gall to come and say, oh, I'm going to clear the canvas and start over. But I haven't seen anyone frustrated by that, I suppose. I did have someone that was very interesting, you know, shortly after I kind of released that, someone started to kind of render a gradient. And they did so, and the tools that you can use to draw on this canvas are very limited. Only a few kind of primitive shapes, lines, for example. And so essentially they were trying to recreate a gradient using lines, single lines of a different gray value. And they would do this, and they would write line after line after line of code, and then someone else would actually come in and then draw a shape that would maybe overlap their lines they've drawn so far, and then someone will, they'd come back in and keep drawing more lines, and I think this person actually got to the point where they were rate limited by Twitter because they were just writing tweets that were so very similar to one another that, anyway. No, there haven't been any kind of outbursts though, so that's exciting, yes.
Thank you so much, Brad, for sharing with us. Your research is fascinating, and I kind of wanted to ask you a question about, because it was near the end when you were talking about eye tracking.
Yes.
And you had mentioned that you're currently working on some studies looking at the notion of, you know, attention and design and how, you know, that those are related. I'm curious what you think about, you know, laptops and technologies now that infuse, of course, you know, eye tracking devices that aren't necessarily ones that you connect to that particular device, but it's embedded in which users now have, in some ways, you know, the you can, of course, you know, hide, right, where you're looking at on the screen, but of course certain things are already predetermined depending on where you're looking and which functions already appear the algorithms that are attached to it. So can you explain a little bit about your thoughts about that?
Sure. So one thing also that I think is important to note about our interest is that we're really not looking at investigating the role of eye tracking within or as kind of an added layer or on top of or as a substitute for, you know, other existing interface or input devices. We're actually looking at, well, what might it mean to design an interface from the ground up? For example, if, you know, instead of the mouse being the first graphical, you know, or first input device for a graphical interface, what if, you know, at Xerox PARC, they didn't develop the mouse, but they first looked at eye tracking as a potential input device? How would that have informed the design of user interfaces? And that's difficult to do. I mean, that's difficult to get in the mindset of thinking for, because, you know, we are so attuned to the way that interfaces currently operate, and like for all the reasons that you just said. The other concern there is that there's, in the hardware that's available for eye tracking currently, there's a wide range of technological specifications. There's also a wide range of cost. And so one thing, as a designer that's fully aware of and concerned with, you know, the user-centered quality of design, cost is a huge issue. You know, we want to be looking at, well, you know, assuming our design plays out, assuming we're able to come up with this approach to interface design that becomes viable and is something that you know, perhaps could make it to market, you know, we want it to be something that, again, is a tool that can, you know, have a degree of accessibility that makes it worthwhile, that makes our efforts worthwhile. So cost is a huge thing, and I mean, that's, this is one of the biggest things. So I just borrowed the Tobii the other day, and, you know, Tobii, there are some issues with Tobii, but you know, when we look at Tobii as one of the players in the market for eye tracking hardware, and then we look at a startup like iTribe. So iTribe was another startup doing eye tracking, looking at eye tracking hardware, and low cost eye tracking hardware. And in December, they were bought out by Oculus, and their products are no longer available. So there's now this huge component of the market, which now again really is kind of empty, and it's kind of unfortunate, particularly because I no longer have access to getting one of these devices. But so, you know, I think that's a consideration. So I think it's in the bigger picture, I think it's actually too early to be thinking about, you know, what the integration of these devices into really a mass market hardware platform might mean. You know, I think we've got to look at, you know, what that cost variable is still. So we'll see. We'll see. Yeah.
Any additional questions?
I had one.
Okay.
So absolutely fascinating. I really liked how, Dan, you touched on the idea of the ability and the potential to collaborate with some other people here at Comm in terms of relative strengths. So I by no means consider myself a designer. At best, maybe sometimes a scientist with a lowercase s and the word social. And so, but some of the words that you mentioned, so empirical or theory in the case of color, when you have a question, what do you do to find an answer? A lot of that maps onto the same sort of process of discovery. And so I was wondering if you could go quickly, and then we'll be in a moment. There's when the slide that had practice led,
oh, yes.
Practice based. When you go about doing research here,
yes.
To what extent? I know with Equal Origins you mentioned color theory.
Sure.
How often is theory kind of informing the process versus raw discovery, empirical results, and then maybe seeing what to do after?
So design theory also, I mean, there is a theory to design, and it's rooted in the visual aspect of design, which is somewhat problematic in the sense that really design has moved beyond simply the visual. And so, but it's rooted in, when we think about things like something, again, like alongside color theory, I might talk about things like the principles and elements of design. So principles, talking about things like hierarchy, looking at things like economy, looking at the simplest solution to a given problem, looking at things like proximity, thinking about gestalt theory, for example, the idea of, which also ties on to the idea of systems design, that systems are built up of components that simply can't operate on their own. They need to work together towards a common goal. And so I'd say that these elements in my particular work, they play a foundational role, if not an explicit part of my process. And I would say that, in particular, they probably play the most into practice like research, where I've kind of situated a lot of my work. But there is that exploratory and experimental side in the sense that, well, yes, perhaps we want to reflect and recognize on what theory may already exist, but if we're going to potentially move beyond it as well and actually grow and expand this point of design, then we can't be beholden to it all of the time. That's probably my response to that.
Thank you not only for answering my question, but all the rest, and sharing this whole talk with us. So once again, everyone, thank you.